Good day to you. This is Tony Ballinger from the Fighting Men of Rhodesia YouTube series. It's my pleasure to have Maj-Genl Roland back for his second talk. His first talk was episode 275, and it covered his time in Rhodesia, where he commanded troops in the southeast. Roland, it's lovely to have you back. We've got a good itinerary to chat about ahead of us. And how are things there in South Africa? Cool, hot, in between?
Fine, man. You know, there's a beautiful saying in English that which says that there's spring is in the air, and you can actually feel it, and it's a wonderful day here in Plettenberg Bay today. Just fabulous.
Well, that's great, and as you can see from the lights behind me and the glow on my face, we've got a rare English day of sunshine, so it's wonderful.
Well, that's wonderful. I love the elephant, the painting of the elephant behind you. Wonderful.
That one was done by a friend of mine. It's an original painting. They're all original paintings.
Yeah.
This one, he writes children's books puts drawings in them, but he's a painter as well. I can't think of his name off the top of my head, but beautiful. I love anything to do with Africa, of course.
Yeah.
Right. Roland, if we can pick up roughly where you left off last time, which is when you left Rhodesia, I think you went back in. What was the first sort of thing you got involved in once you'd left Rhodesia?
Okay. What's the sound like, Tony?
It's good. I can hear you fine.
Is it? Yeah. Wonderful. I can hear people mowing the lawn just next door. So is that disturbing you or not in any way?
Not at all. Not at all.
Right. Tony, as you well know, when I left Rhodesia in January 1980, I flew back by Alouette helicopter to Madimbu, and then I went on my command and staff course in 1980. One of your previous speakers, Boris Borman, who commanded Special Forces later on, he was with me. Excuse me. He was with me on that course. That was a 52-week course, and by the end of 1980, I was appointed commander of 6-1 Mechanized Battalion Group. Probably because of my interest, although I was a paratrooper officer, probably because of my interest in mobile warfare. And at that stage, I had delved into the doctrine, helping to develop the doctrine on mechanized warfare, mobile warfare. And we've already published a few doctrinal publications by that time. So that's probably one of the main reasons why I was appointed commander of 6-1 Mechanized Battalion Group. We always talk about 6-1 Mech. The motto is Mobilitata Vincere, which implies that you can win any battle through mobility and firepower. So that was the main theme, really, of this unit, was a combined arms unit, one of the first, in actual fact, to be experimented with in the South African Army.
Before we go into 6-1 Mech, which is probably going to be the main focus of our talk, I'd like to regress back a bit in your experiences where you actually helped develop the RATL. I find that quite interesting. Could you share that with us?
Yeah, Tony, that will be a great pleasure. In actual fact, I just want to say, didn't have a chance to do so. It's wonderful to be in the company of our Rhodesian veteran friends again. It's people I have huge respect for. And it's also wonderful meeting them all over the world. There's quite a few of them in Australia as well. And just to sit down and have a good talk with them. So thank you so much for this opportunity. Well, right. I would like to go back a bit in history with regards to myself. Early in 1970, in actual fact, in the year 1970, I was transferred from the Darnitron Combat School to the infantry school as one of the officer instructors. Now, I was paratrooper trained, and the whole idea was that I was supposed to be transferred to the parachute battalion, but the infantry school had first choice. And I would say it was fortunate for me that at that stage that I was transferred to the School of Infantry in Oudtshoorn, because I was an ardent student of mobile warfare. And you mentioned when we spoke to each other earlier that I made a study of of the German masters, people like Heinz Guderian.
Yes.
This is the book that he wrote on mobile warfare as such, his biography, and the German concepts of military operations. And then, of course, somebody whom I befriended later on, who wrote Panzer Battles, was General Friedrich Wilhelm von Mallenthin. And I had the privilege to sit down with him, and he taught me the German concepts of mechanized warfare, and I can recite them by heart. The first one is Kessel Schlachten, Battles of Encirclement and Annihilation, very finely attuned to the concepts of warfare alluded to by Rommel. If you one of the good books to read, it was edited by Captain B.H. Liddell Hart, is the Rommel Papers. And one of the concepts that Rommel believed in was that in high-intensity battles, you must be able to split the enemy forces in terms of time and space, and then to concentrate your own forces in terms of time and space and attack the enemy at different times. Now, this is an exquisite example of mobile warfare, and it focuses on the ability to concentrate and to disperse. It's the controlled dispersion and concentration at the right time and place. And something that I studied in depth was his rules for desert warfare. These were the concepts that he utilized in the North African campaign when he fought against the British 8th Army. And I used that almost as an example later on when I became the commander at 6-1 Mechanized Battalion to develop the rules for bush warfare, which is the concepts are very similar. But to come back to my period that I spent at the infantry school from 1917 onwards, I was there for 6 years. I arrived there as a young captain. As I said, I was an ardent student of mechanized warfare. I also followed the concepts that were written by masters on the subject, such as Captain B.H. Liddell Hart, who wrote a famous book, which is called Strategy, in which he also explains the strategy of the indirect approach, how important it is to fight in the physical, the psychological, and the sensory spheres of warfare, and how important it is to follow concepts such as the indirect approach, where deep operations behind enemy lines to create leverage with regards to the one force opposing the other, became sort of, you know, it was so, these ideas were so embedded into my mind that I could later on use that to fill in our own doctrine and to help develop the South African style of warfare for African conditions.
Yeah, now, I think you may agree with me, because I really love armored warfare as well. It's a pet subject of mine. But Guderian and some of his colleagues were the father of the Blitzkrieg, and that's a real iron punch in the middle. But you can't, that one, yeah. You don't always have to do that in an environment where you've got lots of space, lots of land around you. You can do unconventional things like coming in from
absolutely. The... I'll come to that as well in a jiffy, because that is something that Africa taught us. You know, the African way of warfare. So it's very interesting that you mentioned this. And if you look at the concepts of mobile warfare, I always say that it's not only about vehicular mobility, but also and foot mobility, but also the mobility of the mind as well. And if you look at the employment of drones currently in the Middle East, the vertical mobility element as well, as if you see how the various countries, the respective countries, are utilizing drones very effectively in wars, not only in Ukraine presently, but in the Middle East as well. Even the Houthis employing that from Yemen. Anyway, I was studying mobile warfare at the School of Infantry. My commander, really a fine gentleman at that stage, he was Colonel Raymond Holzhausen. He commanded the infantry school. He later on became the director of infantry, and still later on he became a general, and he was responsible for human resource management later on the South African National Defence Force. But he knew that I was studying the concepts of mobile warfare, and at some stage during that, well, early in the 70s, a person who was really far-sighted, who was a visionary, General Constant Viljoen, was commanding the army at that stage. He said that we needed to start investigating the possibilities of increasing the mobility and the firepower of the South African Defence Force, and that we should start looking at the means of fighting in combat group size forces, combined arms elements. So these were the guidelines which he provided for further studies in South African Army. We were fixated at that stage on counter insurgency, as you well know. That was the threat, the total threat, the total strategy, the threat that was posed by the frontline states. We started developing our own counterinsurgency doctrine. We had another fine officer at the infantry school, Major Ivor de Brain. He fought in the Malaysian campaign, and we developed the anti-terrorist operations type doctrines for the infantry school at that stage. But I was extremely fond of the conventional, the more semi-conventional, and the more unconventional side of warfare.
Me too.
So at some stage, General Constant Viljoen said that we must find a replacement for the old six-wheeled Saracen armored personnel carrier, which was a British vehicle, which was developed in, if I can remember correctly, in 1954, even earlier. And we still had a few of them around. And Director Infantry sent a vehicle to the infantry school, which was the German UR-416. Now, we refer to that as the Bochelbeers. Now, in Afrikaans, you will know what that means. Not an extremely stable vehicle. Yeah. It was a counter, it was a riot control vehicle in actual fact. But then Colonel Holzhausen said, Roland, I want you to as a trial, do trials with this vehicle in terms of the development of the new concepts of warfare, and write a report for us on this vehicle. Of course, this vehicle was not suitable for our conditions. Now, the strange part at that stage, there were UN embargoes against our country, so it was very difficult to find vehicles to test. And the type of vehicles that we could get hold of were a range of four-wheeled vehicles, such as the M4, a French Panhard armored carrier.
Yeah.
And later on, we also tested the newly created six-wheeled vehicle, the M6, which was it was just not suitable for our conditions. In actual fact, it sort of sweated oil from every orifice that they had. We didn't have much respect for the French vehicles. There were other vehicles as well, which we tested, such as the Barrier through the 70s, which I became involved in. Now, with the testing of the UR-416, the German vehicle, one early morning at 2 o'clock, still with an HB pencil, I started developing the user requirements for a possible infantry combat vehicle of the future. I studied the German Marder, which was a tracked vehicle, in minute detail. They came into service in the 1970s. We also studied the German concepts of warfare. I mentioned Kesselschlachten. The other important ones are Auftragstaktik, mission command, mobility, which was based on their concept of what they called How do they pronounce it? I can't get onto the German name at this stage. But concepts like Einheitprinzip, you know, integration of effort, etc. Now, what was interesting at that stage was that we got hold of some of the books on mechanized warfare, which was written by the Austrians. And there were some beautiful examples. You will hear me when I converse with you. I normally tell you that I'm marching ready to step forward for the next activity. And they taught us concepts like marching ready, to be prepared. If you say marching ready, there's a range of activities that immediately starts. It's part of your military doctrine to get ready to move at a moment's notice. Others were to be combat ready. If you report combat ready, there are certain actions that take place. And then just before you go into battle, the whole concept of fire ready. Every vehicle under your command and every soldier in your command is ready to fire at moment's notice when they engage the enemy. Now, during that my period at the Army Battle School, I had the privilege to do a special warfare course in Taiwan in 1973 as a young captain. And we were taught guerrilla warfare, conventional warfare, unconventional warfare. They were interesting subjects that was taught to us. We were studying and looking at the Chinese communist tactics, which was used by our own, the forces that we were operating against, the liberation movements. And there was a particular set of doctrine that was written by Mao Zedong that made a lot of sense to me, where he described that you cannot have mobile warfare without guerrilla warfare, and that the right arm, it is like the right arm and the left arm of a boxer, and that it must be used in unison. And that sort of created the basis for the development of our own mobile warfare doctrine. In actual fact, also the development of certain capabilities and certain units, such as 6-1 mechanized battalion group, which could fight a high-intensity mobile battle, a well-balanced task force, and units such as 201 battalion, the Bushmen, and 3-2 battalion, who were more guerrilla-orientated. And later on, through the 80s, these capabilities working together could fight an extremely successful war, where we use unconventional tactics, semi-conventional tactics, sort of unified into one operational concept. And also later on fighting with the UNITA guerrilla force inside Angola, where that guerrilla force, extremely effective, kept more than 55,000 Cubans busy. So this is the whole concept that which you alluded to as well, where when you follow the maneuvers theory of warfare, you develop the capability to fight against a large force with a smaller force by making use of these highly flexible concepts. Now, later on, as we started becoming involved more and more in wars in Angola and also in the northern part of Southwest Africa, what we experienced was that warfare in Africa was not neat and clean, easily comprehensible with sort of conventional warfare on the one side of the spectrum and counterinsurgency or conventional warfare on the other side of the spectrum. By a flick of a switch, you could sort of transfer from the one kind of warfare to the other kind of warfare. And in many cases, we conducted both of these simultaneously. That was one of the roles of 6-1 Mechanized Battalion Group as well. Anyway, when we started with the testing of the different vehicles, I was involved as part of the project team. I was the representative of the infantry school. Later on, Brigadier General Tony Savitas, he was a major at that stage, he became involved in this project as well. And we were responsible to develop the infantry doctrine for mobile warfare, for mechanized warfare at the infantry school. We wrote a few books on this as well. And the two of us presented the first course on mobile warfare at the School of Infantry in October 1975. I was later on transferred to 1 South African Infantry Battalion in Bloemfontein. And we became the home for the development of mechanized doctrine and for the training of young officers and for units with regards to mechanized warfare. And the first course at the unit was presented in October 1976. And that's when the whole concept of mechanized warfare, which was developed by the infantry corps, came into being extremely powerfully so. And our units were ready then to engage the conventional forces of Angola, supported by the Russians and Cuban, from 1978 onwards, and really through the 1980s, when we conducted large-scale external operations into southern Angola, such as Operation Skeptic in 1980, Operation Protea in 1981, Operation Askari in January 1984, and then of course becoming engaged in the major battles in southeast Angola in 1987, 1988, which we refer to as Operations Modular Rupa Packer Displace, and later on Prone, in the western part of Angola. Now, coming back to the testing of the vehicles, we only had four-wheeled vehicles to test, except for a vehicle which was developed by a few German engineers in South Africa at Isandu. It was a six-wheeled vehicle, which was called the Buffalo, the Springfield Buffalo. That was the only six-wheeled contender that was entered into the trials. And it was equipped with a large bus engine, the Bissing, a six-cylinder diesel engine, fabulous engine. When I think about that engine, I think of that the song that was written about a beautiful noise. The first vehicle was equipped with an Allison gearbox. And what was interesting was that the driver's seat was a Leopard tank seat from Germany, which was smuggled through about seven countries, which we later sort of copied and developed into the eventual Rattle infantry combat vehicle. Now, of course, the it was just a magnificent vehicle, the Bissing, the Springfield Bissing, which was called Biffle, and later on it was named Rattle, the Honey Badger. And the initial Rattles were equipped with 20mm guns, which was a I think it was called the French F2 gun, which was a gun which could fire anti-personnel as well as armor-piercing rounds, a high rate of fire, and it was mounted upside down in the rattle, which was slight problem because when you fight in the bush, there's a lot of debris that fall into the working parts of the gun, and one of the drills that we developed was to make sure that the gun, and it had a port at the top for jettisoning the empty shell cases, that we had to keep those the working parts of that gun clean very carefully. Now, of course, the recommendation finally was that the Buffalo should be used as the platform for the further development of the Rattle fleet. Those trials were completed by 1975. I believe that the first four prototypes left Sandok Austral in Boksburg early in 1975. The first four prototypes were taken to the infantry school, and we used that for the presentation of the first courses. But just an interesting little story with regards to the development of the Rattle. The initial financial ceiling for acquiring the vehicle was set at about 65,000 rand. Now, the Springfield Buffalo was a bit more expensive than that, but eventually the High Command of the South African Army approved the recommendation, and we used that platform. We used that platform for the development of the Rattle infantry fleet that was developed later on for the Army.
And how many men could a Rattle carry? Was it 12?
12. Yeah, the crew is 12. I'm talking about the infantry combat vehicle for the infantry. With the 20 millimeter gun mounted. Later on, we developed anti-tank busters as well by placing a Rattle placing an Eland 90 turret onto that vehicle. And yeah, it's the driver, the gunner, the commander, and then a crew of 8 soldiers. And there was a very difficult position at the right rear of the vehicle, which housed the anti-aircraft ring for 7.62 millimeter Browning machine gun, but it was never utilized. It was not practical in the bush because, you know, the bushes just ripped off things that were protruding from the vehicle. And we took a lot of effort to prepare the vehicles for bundu bashing in Angola later on. There were quite a few conversions done to the rattles to prepare them for fighting in bushy conditions.
Tell me, Roland, what decided you against tracked vehicles and in favor of wheeled?
Well, at that stage, tracks were too expensive, and I don't think we had the technical capability to really maintain a large fleet of tracked vehicles. I think the advantages of the rattle with its wheels was soft movement and also movement over long distances. I can remember with one of our operations in 1982 with the 6-1 Mechanized Battalion Group, we bundu bashed for a distance of about 1,600 kilometers during that operation at an approximate speed of about 12 kilometers per hour, taking all our equipment, fuel, after for the helicopters, water with us, bunkers. The column extended for about 53 kilometers in the bush. Jeez. And we never used roads because of the danger of mines. So that was the forte of that vehicle. And it was light on fuel in that sense, because you could bundu bash for a distance of about 600 kilometers and on road travel for distances of about 1,000 kilometers. So that made the vehicle extremely versatile and flexible. There was a bit of a problem with the spacing of the front wheels. And the main reason for that was that the turret hung between the front set of wheels and the rear set of wheels. But still, it is just an amazing vehicle. It was so robust. I always talk about the tenacious rattle. It could just carry on and on and on in the densest bush conditions imaginable.
So tell me, Roland, what is your definition of mobile warfare, and what are the top three tenets that support that definition?
I think what's important about that is the ability to conduct lightning strikes, surprise offensives, at extremely swiftly. But the main tenets of mobile warfare really is that you must be able to move swiftly and travel vast distances and fight behind enemy lines. It provides the ability, in actual fact, to insert forces during day and night time far behind the enemy's forward lines. Now, there are basically two concepts of warfare in play against each other, which we referred to when we started developing the doctrine. And if you look at the circle, at the top part, we talk about the attrition type of warfare, which is very similar to the way the British and the Germans fought during World War I, no man's land, trench warfare as such, where mass and mobility are the attributes that come into play. And then when you look at, in the converse, at maneuver warfare, there are certain aspects which come into play, which makes the employment of mobile forces extremely interesting. The first one is that you must be able not only to control carefully, but also to let the reins loose. I talk about the loose rein, fast rein concept. And that's where the concept of mission command comes from, to allow your juniors to execute at their level and allowing them a lot of initiative in doing so. And then the other important characteristics with regards to maneuver warfare vis-a-vis attrition warfare is the whole concept of physical versus psychological warfare. We also talk in terms of maneuver warfare, the clash of wills. With other words, it's not only the physical aspects of the battle of warfare that comes into play, but the psychological aspects as well. The mind, the morale of your forces. So it's a more flexible type of warfare. And then the last one, which I would like to stress, is the concept of positional versus dynamic warfare. If you think back about if you think back on the employment of the French forces and the British forces during the Second World War, when the war started in 1938, when the Germans took France by means of blitzkrieg, lightning warfare, we spoke about chateau leadership, the French commanders sitting back far behind their own lines,
like drinking, the
drinking wine and relying on information to come from the front by messenger and then making decisions. By that time, Rommel and Guderian and von Manteuffel and Manstein have already reached the shores of Dunkirk. So with regards to maneuver warfare, we talk about the command from the front principle. In other words, the commander is far ahead. He's with his troops in the front line, ready to assist, not taking over command from his juniors, but ready to make quick decisions and then to change the instructions if need be, so that forces can be directed in any direction. It was also in terms of this, it was wonderful studying Rommel when they had to cross the Meuse River, and the area which they selected as their focus of main effort was too strongly fortified by the French army, and they couldn't get through there. And he was on the ground physically reconnoitering a better crossing place and then directing his forces immediately by telling them, this is the next area which you need to need to cross. Mm. Now, something that we learned from the Israelis was the whole concept of change of mission, which we found extremely interesting, and we applied that with regards to the training and preparation of our own forces as well, became part of our doctrine, was that when you prepare for battle, you do that in minute detail, you do proper appreciations, deliberate planning, and then when you enter your training area to exercise, the controlling staff will immediately change the mission so that they can teach the commanders on the ground to make quick appreciations, to readjust, and then to take a new route of action, a new course of action. And I can remember well when I was the commander of 61 Mechanized Battalion Group, we exercised day and night, live firing ammunition, trench clearing, movement day and night, navigational exercises in the bush. We still utilized prismatic compasses at that stage. But something that I was very serious about was the ability of our unit to be able to group and regroup extremely quickly by short command, be it during daytime or nighttime or even under fire. And that was something that we became extremely good at.
I, like you, are very interested in ancient military commanders as well. And I remember reading when Hannibal attacked the Romans, he was a very forceful commander, very, very tenacious. And the Romans couldn't beat him in face-to-face battle until Fabius Maximus came along. And he decided to hit the supply lines of Hannibal. And that war of attrition against his supply lines actually defeated him to the point where he was conquered. Is that a tactic you use in mobile warfare where you really punish the supply lines of the enemy? Did that happen in Angola?
Absolutely. One example was during Operation Meerbos in August 1982. In actual fact, on the 4th of August 1982, we were operating against SWAPU forces in the Kubalai areas, about 270 kilometers north of the border, the Angolan Southwest Africa, now Namibian border. And 6-1 Mechanized was responsible to act as the mobile reserve for the counterinsurgency forces operating against the SWAPU guerrilla forces. Units such as 3-2 Battalion and 1 Parachute Battalion were utilized, and they were using Puma helicopters to attack these bases after they were coated. It was search and destroy type operations. And at one stage, the artillery, or rather the brigade, was 11th Brigade of Fopla, which was deployed at Kuvalai, fired all their artillery ammunition away because they knew that we excuse me, that there were forces operating in their area, and they were afraid of being attacked. But we had strict instructions at that stage not to attack or engage Fopla. And then at some stage, there was a call by 11th Brigade for replenishment of rations and equipment and artillery ammunition from Techimatet, which was about 60 kilometers north of them. And we intercepted their messages that they requested a convoy to come and replenish them. And I received a command to ambush that column. It was about 26 vehicles. And on the 4th of August, I hastily deployed a platoon and put the Mirages on standby. I didn't have time to deploy 6-1 Mech as a whole to conduct the ambush. I moved them closer through the night. And then early that morning, we struck the first two vehicles at 3 o'clock in the morning. They were ambushed by our platoon, and they were destroyed. They, in actual fact, carried artillery ammunition. Wow. And then we went, I had the Alouette gunships put on standby, and they picked me up. And during the fray that next morning, whilst the platoon started clearing the killing area, we flew up and down the road between Techimatet and Kuvalai and shot out another 20 vehicles. Now, this is a typical example of influencing the axis of command and the logistic routes of your enemy. When you look at the concept of mobile warfare, there are three important facets with regards to the employment of your forces, which is firstly preemptive. You must be able to conduct preemptive operations, preemptive strikes, the concept of voorsprong operations. The other one is to psychologically dislocate and disrupt your enemy force. So that places a main emphasis on what we refer to as jackal operations, to psychologically dislocate your force, your enemy force, before attacking them. We had one principle which we followed, which was to make the battlefield fluid. We had extremely flexible leadership and command and management concepts which we followed. And the Angolan forces were addicted to the Russian and Cuban doctrine of attrition warfare. They love to invest towns and to sit behind berms of earth. So they were really fixed to the ground, and they were used to following routes such as river lines and roads, which made them easy to ambush. So this was easy then with forces such as 3-2 Battalion, 201 Battalion, the Bushmen, and units such as 6-1 Mech to dominate your rural areas. In actual fact, that was something that I learned from Mao Zedong, where he says that if you control the rural areas, you control the towns and the main thoroughfares. And yep, these were the type of tactics that we came to utilize.
So really, your tactics are like an octopus, lots of legs. You might have one leg going over there, and quickly another leg can go over there, but all well coordinated. And this absolutely confuses the enemy. They haven't got a clue what's going on.
Absolutely. We use the system of providing such a lot of information to the enemy, and but also by means of deception, we use like the concept of jackal operations to outsmart the foe so that they could not make proper decisions.
All armies run on supplies. I was fascinated in my readings of the German army in the Second World War. They had between 11 and 14 million men under arms, and right up until 1944, excuse me, every single man had a meal every day, which just blows my mind that
amazing.
All that stuff could move and get to a man sitting in a trench. And logistics are a great interest of mine. Now, how did you work in the South African Defence Forces? How did you get a packet of goodies to the guy from a store in the Transvaal to maybe a trench on the borders of Angola? What were the logistics there?
Thanks for asking that question, Tony. I think what we must consider, I know that I sent you a map as well with regards to distances. And we're talking about vast distances. If we look at the Western sub-theater of war, where we fought our battles in the northern area of Southwest Africa, Namibia, and the southern part of Angola, if you travel by road from Pretoria, Johannesburg to Windhoek, via Windhoek to Grootfontein, where we established a large logistic base in 1975, and the Northern Logistic Command. If I can remember correctly, that distance is about 2,300 kilometers. There was also a rail head at Grootfontein, and of course, a reasonably large air force, which could take Mirages and C-130s and C-160s. So if we look at supporting forces and resupplying forces in Southwest Africa, the northern part of Southwest Africa, which we refer to as the operational area, we talk about vast distances and support from the base areas in Pretoria, Johannesburg, and other areas in South Africa happened by air, by road, and by rail. And from Grootfontein, which was extremely well-organized logistic base, beautifully developed in 1975. It had technical workshops, signal workshops, large medical installations, maintenance units. We could supply the whole operational area from Grootfontein. The distance was about 265 kilometers from there to Rundu. From where the operations in southeast Angola were supported. And then from Rundu, there was a dirt track leading to Mavinga, about 380 kilometers, if I can remember correctly. Not an easy road to follow, which was used by our SAML hundreds and 50s and 20s for the support of our forces at the front. And then from Mavinga, where we established a brigade administrative area, close to the airport, the forces inside the battle arena for distance of about 150 to 180 kilometers were supported by our SAML logistic vehicles. An interesting story that I would like to share with you with regard to the resupply of our forces, because we utilized vast amounts of artillery ammunition. For the G5 guns, 155 millimeter rounds, which are quite heavy. And then, of course, the rockets for the multiple rocket launcher, the Valkyrie, the 127 millimeter rocket launchers. At night, because of the air threat, the C-160s and the C-130s flew from Rundu to Mavinga in sorties. There was a contingent of UNITA soldiers deployed at Mavinga, who listened to our aircraft coming into land, and then they would light up a flare path with tins, you know, it was almost candles, to light up the flare path. The C-130 will land and turn around, and whilst it was still in motion, the equipment and the ammunition was offloaded, and then it took off again to Rundu to replenish for the next round. So this was something which happened continuously during the battles in Southeast Angola from that period, September, October, November, December, and then into 1988 as well, the replenishment of our forces. Now, with regards to units such as 6-1 Mechanized Battalion Group, which was a well-balanced force, infantry, armor, artillery, anti-aircraft engineers, and then the combat service support units, the HQ company, which was responsible for the administration and logistic support of our unit. We had a well-organized echelon, which we referred to as A echelon, first-line support of our unit in the field. We could operate for about 10 days independently in southeast Angola, carrying with us all our equipment, our ration packs. We had a doctor, we had a chaplain, we had all the necessary support elements with us. And we carried our own rations, our own fuel, lubricants, spare axles, spare engines. Our technical staff could replace an axle in the field overnight. And then many a time we needed to replace engines in the field, which took us about 20 minutes to take the engine out and put the next one back. That's so cool. We were quite independent. And then we also relied on air support, of course. And for operations of long duration, especially when we fought deep inside southern Angola, we made use of helicopter administrative areas where we, but never stationary for too long, where we established tactical HQs in the field and protected them with small protection elements. But we could use that as a sort of a base for replenishment. And we could send in columns into the field to replenish our forces far inside Angola with our logistic vehicles, of course, then escorting them inside, in and out. But normally the whole idea was that we would not operate for too long duration inside Angola. Operation Protea, for example, started on the 24th of August. That was HOT day. And within 12 days, we had completed that operation, destroyed two enemy brigades, and of course, a few swapo positions as well. So it was moving swiftly into your combat zone and then out again. Later on, we became involved in operations of long duration, where we operated against the swapo guerrillas, the People's Liberation Army of Namibia. Now, I'm thinking of Operation Meerbos now in 1982. That operation started in July 1982. It ended in mid-August 1982. So that was the period, normally 6 weeks in and then out.
Really fascinating. And with the military vehicles that you used in that were the Rattles, and I noticed reading through some of your notes that there were ZT-3s that were slightly more effective against T-55. What was the difference between them and a standard rattle?
Well, the ZT-3 is very much like the what is the guided missile used by the Americans? I'm thinking it's not the law, was it the law?
I'm not sure. I think the law is the English one. Is it? I forget.
Okay, it was mounted on the rattle. It was a guided missile, second generation guided missile, which could hit tanks at about 5 kilometers, distance of about 5 kilometers. Now, they were still under test and evaluation in September, October 1987, when we conducted Operation Protea. And 3-2 Battalion were equipped with ZT-3s. I think they had about 4 ZT-3 rattles. Which we utilized against enemy tanks on the Lombard River. One of their commanders, he became quite famous later on, was Hannes Nordmann, extremely effective armor officer. And he had a crew of national servicemen. And in September, they destroyed quite a few enemy tanks who tried to cross the Lombard River. Now, what was interesting about that operation was that there were still a few engineers who operated with our troops in the front line, who accompanied them in battle. And those weapons were under test and evaluation, and some of them missed their targets, but they were highly effective. And so, in actual fact, they were tested under battle conditions. So it was an anti-armor weapon system.
The last question I want to ask you before we get into a couple of nitty-gritty examples of 6-1 mechanized operations. The MiG-21s and 23s seem to have superiority over the aircraft that South Africa produced, the My mind's gone blank. The Mirages.
Yeah.
What was the reason for that? I thought the Mirages, the F1s and so on, were pretty good aircraft.
They were, Tony, but at that stage, they had become outdated. So we fought during that war, we fought under dire conditions with regards to air support. The enemy had complete air superiority. I must say that our Air Force, the Mirages, the Buccaneers, and even the Impalas, conducted extremely effective ground attack sorties. And the Air Force developed, because of the major anti-aircraft threat, our Mirage pilots, they were good. They developed the concept of flying very low and then doing what we refer to as toss bombing, about 8 kilometers from the target, extremely accurate, so that they could neutralize the threat of the enemy's anti-aircraft weapon systems. Now, the simple explanation with regards to the fact that we couldn't conduct counter-air operations was that the MiGs, the 21 and the 23, could outmaneuver the Mirage. But more importantly so, we didn't have radar coverage in southern Angola, and they did have radar coverage in the areas where we fought. And at that stage, the enemy had a front sector missile, which they could fire at any direction to engage the Mirages. And our own aircraft, I'm not an Air Force pilot, but I can remember that we spoke a lot about this during the days that we fought in Angola, was that our own Mirages had to get behind a MiG aircraft to fire the anti-air missiles.
Gee, that's interesting.
And so then the enemy reigned supreme in the skies during Operation Modular Hooper Packer and Prone as well.
And I think South Africa's response was, because of sanctions, that they had to develop their own cheetah, which I think was a bit of help from the Israelis, maybe from the Kavir. I don't know, but that was a lovely plane. I saw it flying over an air display in Zimbabwe. A beautiful plane.
No, I think they were still in development at that stage, Tony.
Yes, this, when I say in Zimbabwe, it was about 1980s sometime.
Yeah, correct.
Yeah, it had a tanker in front of it and a couple of other Mirages, the normal types. Yeah. But
the person who wrote excellent books on that was Dick Lord.
Yes. Oh, yes. Yeah. He's famous.
He's quite a famous SAF pilot.
Yes.
And if I can remember correctly, he's just a wonderful person. We spoke a lot when we were engaged in these battles. And unfortunately, he passed away. But if I can remember correctly, he was a top gun pilot that was trained by the Americans at the...
Exactly. I said this to an American once, that it was a South African pilot that helped establish Top Gun, and I was boo-hooed and all that sort of stuff. But I've got his book here, Flamgat.
Flamgat, yeah.
And that's very interesting reading.
Tony, what's the name of the English book? Flamgat is to have a fire up your backside.
That's right. That's the title on the English book, is Flamgat. Yeah.
Well, okay. All right.
So he didn't change that at all. I think we more or less understand what that means. Mm-hmm. It's the afterburner, but also in a more slightly derogatory way. But I would like now, if possible, to spend maybe 20 minutes on giving me a flavor of some of the battles that you were involved in with 61 MEC, or any other unit that you commanded that may be of real interest to us.
Tony, you're making me work very hard this afternoon. But to give a short summary, I'm going to mention a few of the operations that I was fortunate to participate in. Of course, the apart from a few counterinsurgency operations with units such as 1 South African Infantry Battalion, the operations that we were engaged in Rhodesia in 1997-1980, which we refer to as Operation Bowler. Another well operation that we participated in as 61 Mechanized Battalion Group were deep incursions by SWAPU's Typhoon forces into the area which we refer to as the triangle of death, the Tsumeb Poortawe Grootfontein area, high intensity counterinsurgency battles that we were involved in 1981 and 1982. The first one was called Operation Carrot, and the one in 1982, Operation Yahoo, respectively. And then other well-known battles that we were employed in was Operation Protea in 1981, August, September 1981, which was a large-scale operation. We utilized two brigades. Task Force Alpha was a conventional brigade comprising four combat groups, Combat Group 10, 20, 30, and 40. 10 was 6-1 Mechanized Battalion Group. And our mission was to attack and destroy FAPLA brigade positions at Sangongu and Onkiva, and control that area for more than 14 days so that we could break the relationship that existed between the Angolan conventional forces and, of course, the SWAPO forces, the liberation forces of the People's Liberation Army of Namibia that we were fighting against. So the one task force was responsible for the conduct of a conventional style operation, swift and sweet. It was a surprise offensive, quite a violent operation. And then we had another task force consisting of 2 to 3 combat groups, which conducted simultaneously conducted counterinsurgency operations in the area of Mupa and Kuvalai, a bit further to the north, and specifically on the logistic and command lines of the enemy. Later on, I was transferred to the Army Battle School. My instructions were that we needed to start training our conventional forces in the tactics that we were expounding in at 6-1 MEC, and which we had learned during operations such as Skeptic and Protea. And then Operation Askari took place in 1983, December 1983, January 1984. The commanders who took over from me was commandants at that stage, Lieutenant Colonels Gert van Sail and F. van Lille. And then I was involved in operations in Southeast Angola again in 1987, Operation Modular. And then whilst I was in Angola, I was appointed commander of the South African Army College. And as soon as I took over command of the college, by May that year, the 5th Cuban Division of the Cubans, well, the 5th Cuban Division, employed with FAPLA in Southwest Angola, and they posed a major threat. And I was appointed as the second in command / chief of staff of a newly established division based on the headquarters of Sector 10. We refer to that as 10 Division, which was made ready to counter the threat posed by the 50th Cuban Division and the FAPLA forces deployed in the southwestern theater of war, just across the border of Ovamoland. Those were the last operations that we conducted, because by 22 August that year, it was decided to start making peace with the Angolans and the Cubans, and there was a ceasefire agreement which came into play, and we were still planning for a possible attack by the Cubans and the Angolan forces. We did a lot of contingency planning in those days. And then eventually, peace ensued on the 22nd of December, 1987. And hostilities ended between the South African forces, the Angolans, and the Cubans. The war against SWAPO still continued, but peace ensued on the 1st of April of the next year, 1988.
My second last question is how many men were under your command in that division, Roland?
Normally, with regards to 6-1 MEC, the combat size was about 800 to 1,000 men. Depending on the operation, this could become more. During Operation Yahoo in May 1982, I had 3,000 men under command.
Okay.
Almost the size of a brigade. And of course, the battles that we fought in Southeast Angola in 1987, 1988, our brigade sized force was consisted of not more than 3,000 men. And we were fighting, outnumbered, really, because we were fighting with one brigade against approximately eight brigades and two tactical groups. So the enemy was more than 20,000 men in the field. But we were fighting with UNITA, and we had the advantage of the G5 gun, which became a maneuver force in its own right. We would have, I don't know what would have happened if we didn't have the rifles and the G5 guns and the multiple rocket launchers. Those weapon systems became game changers and saved the day for us.
Were you involved in the Battle of the Lumba, where the 49th Brigade was messed up at that river? Was that part of your operation?
3rd of October.
Yeah.
47th Brigade.
47th.
Was destroyed by 6-1 Mechanized Battalion.
Yeah.
Under the command of Commandant Kubus Smith, Hawk Smith, as we know him. It was an excellent battle. I was sent to Angola just after that battle. And in actual fact, arrived there later on in October and started with the planning for the attack on 9 Brigade of, oh sorry, 16 Brigade of FAPLA on the 9th of November, which was deployed at the source of the Shambinga River. And what was interesting about the planning and the preparation for that battle was that we coordinated the attack extremely well with Savimbi and his guerrilla commanders. So it was a well-coordinated attack. Myself, Fred Utschig, and John Loosberg flew at night to Mavinga and were whisked away in a brand new Casper vehicle, which was given to Savimbi by the South African Army. And somewhere in the trench systems underground, with the maps against the earth walls, we coordinated that attack with Savimbi and his generals sitting there around the tables which were given to them by the South African Army, wooden teak tables.
Wonderful. My last question, really, the battle in the Tumpo Triangle, the frontal assault on Quito Carnaval, where the South African tanks got bogged down in a minefield, that's quite a controversial thing militarily. Was that frontal attack a mistake, or was it conducted to give Castro a chance to get out of Angola?
You're drawing me into a killing area now, Tony. Okay. Now, I was outspoken about that because I left Angola when Operation Modular ended late in December 1987. And we fought a mobile war to the true sense of the word. Now, if you look at mobile warfare or maneuver, following the maneuver theory of warfare vis-a-vis the attrition theory of warfare, the criterion for success on the battlefield for attrition war is to hold ground successfully. Now, this is actually what happened at Quito Carnavale after the Cuban forces and the FAPLA forces supported by the Russians were reinforced to establish an extremely strong defensive line at Quito Carnavale by utilizing the Quito River as a major obstacle. And of course, the minefield belts surrounding Quito Carnavale. Now, when we fought the operations during Operation Modular, we provided plans to the Army High Command and the South African Defense Force to assault Quito Carnavale from the west with a surprise offensive, which was not approved by the General Staff. They were afraid of losing too many casualties. To my mind, that did not make sense. And of course, they were afraid of escalating the war to a regional status. And it was decided to keep on grinding from the east. Now, myself and at that stage, I was working very closely with Colonel Dion Ferreira, who was a former commander of 32 Battalion a person with an exquisite tactical mind. We proposed to the generals not to become involved in the attrition battles in the area which we referred to as the Kwatir and the Tumpu areas, because in actual fact, you were fighting against the whole strength of the FOPLA force deployed there, supported by the Cubans and the Russians, and all their artillery. I mean, how do you cross a river under those conditions? And during the last, just before I left, the final proposals we made to the generals was not to become involved in that battle. And then the general staff decided that we should keep on grinding against the battle, against the enemy, and try and cause as many casualties as possible to make it impossible for them to sort of start the offensive against Mavinga and Jamba again. To my mind, that was an error. We should have. My proposal was that we should keep a small token force in place there, which later on happened, but battalion-sized force working with FOPLA just to keep the enemy force in place. So to my mind, that was an error, and I think it was propaganda-wise, it was exploited well by Fidel Castro, because the whole criterion for success of your mobile warfare is to maintain your mobility. We gave our mobility away there. I always alluded to the fact that we landed in an attrition trap. And I gave lectures on this at the Army College. And at some stage, some senior officer, a brigade at Joint Operations, sent me a message and said, Roland, you must stop talking about the attrition trap. And telling the guys we made an error of continuing the fighting along the eastern eastern approaches towards Kwetekanavale.
It's lovely to hear your view on that. I keep having a few questions, but this is definitely the last one. Did you have any Americans or British people snooping around the front during the war in Southwest Africa to pick ideas or give ideas? Did you ever meet anybody like that in an official or unofficial level?
Yeah, you ask interesting questions, Tony.
Well, if anything,
you know, there were rumors. Yeah. Firstly, with regards to the battles fought in Southeast Angola, we knew that the Americans were supporting Zavimbi with his main headquarters deployed at Jamba in the southeastern part of Angola from Zaire. We knew that. We also knew that they probably had CIA teams operating with them in the bush, because we saw the Stinger man-portable air defense systems. But there was quite a few times that we could see Stingers being fired at MiG aircraft. But we never saw the teams. It was kept extremely secret. I don't know if any of our forces ever saw an American team deployed there or see an American team utilizing Stinger missiles. So, yeah, but to my mind, there were American forces operating. I know that they were watching us by means of satellite. And I met an American officer a few years later. Yeah, I think he was a military attaché in Pretoria, and said, why didn't you guys attack the enemy from the west? I said, this is another subject that's sort of very sensitive to talk about.
Yeah.
And then people like General Westmoreland, he visited our forces in Southwest Africa, and I know that he was extremely impressed by the tactics utilized by our forces on the ground, specifically with reference to the counterinsurgency concepts that was utilized. And a lot of those recipes were taught to us by the Rhodesians.
Excellent. What a wonderful talk. Thank you so much, Roland. It's been absolutely wonderful. I've been so looking forward to this talk, and it's lived up to every expectation of mine. You're a very, very interesting man to listen to. You're highly regarded and respected by your peers. And thank you so much for spending time with a little lieutenant like me to talk about all of this. It's been incredible. And I do apologize, even live here recording, if I ask questions that are controversial. It's just part of my nature. And I hope everything that I said and did and asked of you was okay.
So I was always seen as a sort of a rebel in the military. So I'm not afraid of answering controversial questions directly, Tony. So thanks for that as well. And it's nice to reflect on that. I would just like to say that English is not my first language, but through conversing with you and our Rhodesian friends, I'm getting nightmares in English these days. It's wonderful talking to you. Thank you so much for this opportunity. And blessings to all of you. And we learned so much from our fighting days and, you know, the humane stories as well. And we had a certain dictum at 6-1 MEC. We said that every person matters. Every person counts. It doesn't matter whether it's a chef or Tiffy, a technician, or doesn't matter at all. A troop. So a lieutenant, a general, to our mind, everyone matters. Thank Amen. You so much.
Amen. Thank you, sir. I really thank you for this talk, and God bless you.
Thank you, Tony.